Well, welcome to this webinar, and I'm really happy to see that there is so much interest. Just noticed that there were over 100 participants, so that is really exciting. Sophie and I will give you an update on what has changed in the schema version and how you can benefit from it. My name is Madeleine de Smale. I work at the TU Delft Library in the Netherlands, and I'm co-chair of the Metadata Working Group. Sophie, do you want to say something to introduce yourself?
Good morning, everyone. I'm a member of the Working Group, and I work as a librarian at the National Research Council of Canada.
Thank you. Here, a short overview of what to expect in this hour. Please note that there will be a live Q&A session, so submit any questions you may have in the chat or save it for later. And if time permits, we will also have a feedback session on the work of the Metadata Working Group. We will use Mentimeter for that, so keep your mobile phone or another device ready. The Metadata Working Group consists of the following members, a nice mix of people with both a technical programming background and librarians. The metadata schema is the backbone and at the heart of data site services and has become a widely known standard. The Metadata Working Group maintains data site's metadata schema in consultation with data site members and under the guidance of the data site board. A short tech update to start with. To support the new metadata schema, DataSite is updating the services to enable users to create and update the UIs with the new metadata schema. The changes to the DataSite services to support metadata schema 4.4 are carried out in two phases to enable immediate access to non-breaking changes. Phase one, which was released at the end of March, includes support for metadata schema 4.4 that does not require breaking or complicated changes to the REST API version 2. Please note that related item, which is one of the new changes to this schema version, is currently only available via the MDS API and XML file upload in the Fabrica interface, so not via the form. Phase two, which will be released later this year, will include support for the full metadata schema 4.4 via the REST API version 3 and Fabrica and via the Fabrica interface. Version 4.4 is backwards compatible, meaning that the changes made don't affect preceding minor releases of version 4. And of version 4.0, you only need to specify the major version in your metadata submission, so you can already take advantage of these updates without having to change anything else about how you send metadata to DataSite. Please note that version 3 of the metadata schema is still supported, but be aware that version 3 is the preferred one. Focus of 4.4 is to provide better support for textual publications. And although it has always been possible to register DOIs for text publications, there was a great need from the user community for metadata fields in which information related to text publications could be included in a structured way. And since we are not solely focusing on research data, we have decided to reflect that in the title of the documentation. So you may have noticed that the title, you've added other research outputs at the end of the title. just a few numbers that show that more support for text publication is warranted. The number of registered DOIs for text publications with resource type text is almost the same as for datasets. After datasets, most DOIs are registered for text publications. So it was about time we started to pay more attention to this. And now we really get to the schema updates. The first change I want to highlight is related to the subject property. Subject terms describe what the research is about, usually derived from some type of vocabulary or schema. Applying structured term entries provides greater consistency in search results for users. Subjects also group related resources and enable exploratory browsing and searching. And that's why this property is in the schema documentation indicated with a gray shade, meaning that it's a recommended property. And in addition to the subproperties subject scheme, scheme URI, and value URI, the new subproperty classification code has been added to indicate the classification code associated with the subject term in a subject scheme. To give you a little bit more detail and explanation of what we mean by this, the most widely used subject classification we currently find in DataCite metadata is the Australian and New Zealand Standard Research Classification Fields of Research. This subject scheme is broken down into divisions, the broadest level with two digits. In this example, it's chemical sciences. It's the, then you have a category of finer detail, which are the groups with four digits, and then the fields, the finest level with six digits. And these six digits indicate the classification code related to the subject term. This is an example how that looks like. In this example, the classification code is in particular useful because this subject scheme, this Australian New Zealand classification scheme, does not have value URIs for each subject term. Instead, the classification code can be used, can be added that identifies the subject term. Related to that classification code. But of course, when the subject scheme is supporting both value URIs and classification codes for subject terms, you can use both subproperties. Another important change is the addition of specific resource types, such as journal article, dissertation, etc., and also includes computational notebook and peer review, so that these types can be better identified. We believe this is a huge improvement compared to previous schema versions, where you can only select text, with optionally the resource type property to indicate more detail. The only exception between all these text-related resource types is computational notebook. Computational notebooks are virtual notebook environments used for programming and computing. And a well-known example is the Jupyter notebook. And because we see an enormous growth in the use of these platforms, we felt that we should support that. A special note about output management plan. DataCite supports data management plan identifiers since the schema version 4.4. A DMP ID is a unique persistent identifier for a data management plan. A DMP ID is a DOI with a resource type general output management plan. And since the release of this schema version, this resource type general is now included in the schema. And with the term output management plan, we cover both data management plan and software management plan. And I think I will now hand over to Sophie, who will explain more about the related item property.
Hi, everyone.
And Madeleine? Yeah, I think I need to stop now, eh? Stop sharing or?
Okay.
Yeah.
I will share my screen. And I had it on slide 12. Move to the next slide. This is the other change in schema 4.4 that we wanted to share with you. It's the addition of a new relation type value is published in. The relation type is a subproperty of the existing related identifier property 12 and the new related item property, which we will present in the next few slides. With this new relation type value is published in, you're able to refer to the container or series in which the described object is published. We consider the series or other containers like journal and book to be a related item. The last change we present is the addition of a new property, related item. It was added to accommodate at least two use cases. First, to provide structured text citation information. The initial requests for structured text citation, and this was the main driver for this change, have come from data site clients who do have an identifier for related items, but whose aggregators have additionally asked for explicit text citations. The new related item property accommodates that initial request. It also accommodates a second use case to provide information about a related item that does not have an identifier. You can now include a related item with or without an identifier, and you can include parsable metadata about each related item. So as I just mentioned, related item can now be used to include citation, publication information, or series information of related resources with or without identifiers. The subproperties included were chosen to facilitate both use cases. All subproperties are optional except for two, which express the type of relationship. Related item is used both, two of the subproperties are mandatory and they express the type of relationships. When related item is used, both the related item type and the relation type are required. Be aware that for related item type, the same controlled values can be used as for resource type in property 10, and that for relation type, the same controlled values can be used as in subproperty 12b. This example shows how series information like series title, volume, issue, page numbers can be included in a discrete, specific designated subproperties. In this example, the described resource is the journal article, which is published in a journal. The related item includes information about the journal, its title, volume, etc. In the previous schema versions, series information could be included as part of the description property with a description type series information. But it was just an unstructured text string of which the various elements are difficult to parse. So although series information is not deprecated, we strongly recommend using the new related item property. This example shows how a related item can be used to provide metadata about a report series. In this example, the described resource is a report that is published in a series with a series number. Another example here, the described resource is a book chapter, which is published in a book. The subproperties include the publication information related to the book, and it includes editor, which is indicated in the contributor subproperty. Here's another example. This one is of a paper published in a series, but it is a reprint of an article that was first published in a journal. So the related item describes the original journal article. And the related item then can provide the DOI of the journal article, the title of the journal article, and its publication. We have one last example for related item. This one, it shows how a citation information of a resource related to the one being described can be included in the metadata. In this example, there is no related item identifier, but it includes important citation information, creator, title, publication year, and publisher. I will stop sharing and back to Madeleine.
Slideshow. Sorry about that. What's to expect next? Well, first, I would like to update you that we will make available soon the updated crosswall between DataCite and Dublin Core. We're just about to release that, and it will be announced separately, well, I think in a few weeks now, when it's available. And after that, we will start our work on the next version. We have already some topics on our working list, of course, suggested by the community. This is just a few examples, but of course our list is much larger. And if you have any suggestions yourself, be it a minor or major change, well, we would warmly welcome your suggestions. The schema is ultimately there for you and should meet your needs as much as possible. So questions and any comments about the schema are would be highly appreciated. You can use the feedback link at the of the Google discussion group on the schema homepage at schema.datasite.org, or just send a note to support at datasite.org. It's not yet decided if the next version will be a major release or another minor release. That's just depending on the topics, how big they are, and if they affect any changes if they break the changes to the preceding minor versions of Schema 4. Okay, these are the updates about the schema. And there is now time to take questions from you.
So we don't have any questions in the chat at the moment. Does anybody have a question for Madeleine or Sophie at this point? Yes. Suzanne, is it possible to capture citations from within an article?
From within an article. Can you give me a little bit more context about that? I think it can. We do have subproperties that are related to journal information. Is that what is meant?
From the reference lists at the end of an article.
Oh, at the end, okay, a citation. Yes, well, in principle, it's you should be able to include that in the related item property, because we support related items support title, of course, authors, publication year. Dus yes, you should be able to include that information in the related item property.
Yes, and our last example for the related item, we showed a relation type is cited by.
Yeah.
So that can be used for references, or cites is the other. And I think in this particular question, cites would be the relation type that would be most
appropriate. Okay, yeah.
Okay. Great. Thanks, Susan. Then we have a question from Holger saying, how is the upcoming support for PIDs for instruments going to look like?
We have not figured that out yet. We will, I think it's a suggestion that came up in an RDA working group. So I think we will align with that group on that, but it's not figured out how that will look like. We just have to start with discussions about that. Is that okay. An answer on the question? I'm not sure. It's maybe a bit vague yet, but yeah, this is.
Yep. That sounds good, I think. So then we have another question from Abdoulaye saying, is the updated schema already in use?
Yes, it is in use. Yes, it's published on the data site of schema homepage, schema.datasite.org. You can find it there.
Yeah. I will share the link to that in the chat. Okay, I think that's all of the questions. Amy has a question here. Could you say again whether it was the form or the file upload for Fabrica that has been updated to support the new schema?
Yes, the form is almost supporting the full schema, except for the related item property. But I suppose we will share the slides after this session.
Yeah, so the file upload supports the full XML.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The XML is supporting the full schema. Yeah.
Okay, another question here is about relation type is version of seems to go only one way from version A to version B. But how would you describe the relation between two publications that are more or less the same, but only their title page changes. We see that in some publications where the same book is published at two different publishers, weird but true, would you recommend is variant form of?
I don't know out of my all the relation types, but
would you repeat the question, because I form is for a different format.
Well, the question is about relation type between two books that are
very similar but
not the same. And so you have the relation type is version of, or you have is variant form of. So I think they're just asking for some clarification about the difference there, but
looking at has version. Is version of an instance of a target resource? Is version of indicates A is a version of B, whereas is new version of, as you said, goes in a specific direction, and is previous version of goes in the opposite direction.
Yeah.
All three exist.
Okay, so you have a backwards version, a backwards way of describing is version of, is previous version.
Is previous version of.
Okay. So the next question is, when will the metadata schema form be modified according to the update, or has this been done? So the work around the form, I think, I don't know if Martin, you're on the call, if you wanted to speak about that briefly. Well, this work is scheduled. I know this work is scheduled for quarter three of this year. So as you said, Madeline, it was already the is published in the new resource type is already supported.
All resource types are supported. Only the related item property is only available in the MDS API and via the XML upload in Fabrica. But in the quarter three of this year, the full metadata schema will be supported in the API, in the REST API version 3, and in the Fabrica interface. Yeah.
Great. Okay. So then we have another question that says, could you repeat the timeline for the REST, for the updated REST API, and when we can use 4.4 with the REST API? So that's also quarter three, I think, when this will be supported in the form.
Yes, I'm not sure about a real exact timeline. That's not my my area.
Yeah, no worries. I think we can say Q3 for now. Let me just see. There's quite a few questions coming in, so I just want to make sure we have time for this, or you have another section?
Yes, we have time. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, okay, question regarding versioning. The documentation on versioning does not clarify when you would recommend versioning, such as Crossref does. What exactly is a minor change versus a major change? So slightly going off towards something different here, but I don't know if you feel you would like to comment on that, Madeline or Sophie.
Well, a major change will be released when there are breaking changes with preceding minor versions of the release of the version 4.
Oh, sorry. I think this is referring to when to assign a new DOI to a different version of. So in the schema documentation, it's up to each individual steward to decide when a new DOI should be assigned to a major new version of a resource. And so I think this question is about what is a major change to a version of a resource that's being shared.
Well, I would say if the content has changed, the data files or important metadata has changed, then it is recommended to issue a new DOI. But if there is only a small typo somewhere in the metadata, then you can you don't need immediately to update with a new DOI. But that is also more
Okay.
How I would explain it, but yeah.
Yeah, I think that's good. Feel free to keep adding more questions or more context if you want more information in the chat. So just one last question here, I think, that says, on the last slide, support for PIDs for instruments, did you mean data collection instruments under instruments?
With instruments, it's meant the instruments by which data are collected, for example. That is how I would explain instruments. So, for example, you can add an identifier, for example, to a measuring instrument or maybe a radar somewhere. And then you can attach a DOI to that instrument, which allows you to collect all data sets generated by that instrument, for example.
Okay. Great. So finally, let's just answer this question. Is there a way to comply with the initiative for open citations other than connecting the single citations via the related item?
Well, I have to apologize for that. I'm not sure. I would not see how to answer that question. I will take that to the metadata working group. If you don't mind. It's a good,
good question. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, so then we have a sort of comment here that says social sciences use instrument to refer to a, for example, questionnaire, which is different from a physical machine like a telescope or a microscope.
Okay, yeah.
Then we have a final comment that says, could you please share the slide to about instruments again?
Okay.
That seems to be causing some interest.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's a new topic, yeah? So it's something that we should start, that we are now starting the discussion about in our working group. So. But if there is so much interest, we can perhaps update you somewhere in between our discussions. I'm not sure. Yeah.
Okay, great. I think, here's a question. Which resource type general do I use for an article in a collected edition? Book part is not possible. Should we use book chapter?
An article in a book edition.
In a collected edition.
In a collected edition. Yeah. But Sophie, do you know? You are more of the text publications, but I would say chapter, but.
We have that challenge with mods also, and we choose to use chapter.
Yeah.
Okay, great, thank you. There is some more chats happening, but I don't think we have any specific questions. So would you like to move on to the...
Yeah, can we save the questions in the chat, Mary, do you know that?
I should be able to export them for
okay.
you.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Yes, I think we now come to the feedback session. We would like to gather your feedback about the use of the documentation. Does it work for you? Are there any challenges? and what you expect from us regarding communication. So we've prepared a few questions, not that much. So maybe Mary, you can share. Oh, I will need to stop sharing, I suppose.
Yeah, sorry. Okay.
And if you would like to go to menti.com and enter the code that is on the screen. And the first question is just to get a sense how often you use the schema documentation yourself. Well, it's interesting to see these numbers. But there are also people on the call who rarely use the schema documentation. Would of course mean that they are not in a position to register the UIs, or that they are used to register the UIs with the same metadata and that there's no need to change that. Yeah.
Just let me know when you want to move on to the next
thank
question.
You. I think it's really interesting for us to know. Yeah. You can move on to the second question.
Okay, great.
We would like to know if the documentation works for you. Over the years, it has grown to a big monster that may be difficult to handle. So we wondered if it would help if the documentation were split in, for example, resource type, so that only the document information that applies to that specific resource is offered. You can think of, for example, a schema specifically for text publications, or a schema specific for data, or schema specific for software. Would that work better for you?
What were the different profiles you had in mind there, you just said?
Yeah, just another a separate schema. Just forget the word profile. Just a separate schema for a specific resource type. And we have now a really concise edition with for everything. And if you're, for example, working only with text publications, would it be helpful if you have only a schema, a metadata schema only related to text publications?
I don't know if there's an issue here, or is the voting working?
It shows 41 responses.
That's a shame. Let me see if I can. There we go.
Oh, yeah. Oh, better. That's better. Okay.
Cool. Okay.
Thanks. Let's see. I think we can move on to the next question. This question is about communication. How can we improve communication to gather your feedback? which channels to use, whether there are specific training needs for the schema documentation, etc. And you can please enter any suggestion you may have. Okay. Oh. Well, thank you. That is really useful feedback. Good to know that more examples are needed. I think the metadata working group was always a little bit reluctant with too much examples, but well, if that works best, then I think we should do that. Yeah.
Still a few answers coming in.
Yeah. Well, thanks. And then I think there is a last question.
Yep.
It is a quite open question. Again, do you have other suggestions for us that we should be working on? Think of improving the schema documentation, think of layouts, the structure, the language, or if we should work on interoperability with other schemas, and which, or any other topic. Yeah, please enter any suggestion you may have. Yeah. Yes, and I can already say that schema.org is on our list. And has been asked previously. Yeah. And good practice is shown as a big word, so I think that is also something that should have our attention, or at least attention of data side, I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, thank you.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll stop sharing.
Well, I think we come to the end. Well, this is the final slide. I just want to thank you for your joining this webinar, for your suggestions, for your valuable feedback. And if you want to get in touch with us, please do. We welcome any suggestion you have, and I would like to thank Miri for your support preparing this webinar. Thank you.